Our next speaker is Professor Linda Stech. It is my great pleasure to introduce her. While she can already set up her slides, I would like to shortly introduce her research. So Professor Stech is a professor of environmental psychology at the University of Groningen, where she also received her PhD. Among other numerous distinctions, she is a member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences and has been appointed Knight of the Order of the Netherlands Lion. Professor Stech was among the lead authors of the IPCC report, Global Warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius, and is currently lead author of the sixth assessment report of the IPCC. She was recognized 5 times by Thomson Reuters ranking as one of the world's most influential scientific minds. Today, she will tell us about her recent research, which focuses on understanding what affects people's motivation to act pro-environmentally. Professor Stech, if everything is ready, then the stage is yours. Please, I would like to also ask you to turn on your video. And unmute, please. Thank you very much.
Unmute. I don't see the unmute.
No, you're already unmuted.
Oh, okay. Yes, do you hear me? Do you see my
Yes.
slide?
Yes, good. Everything is ready.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your invitation. So I will shortly tell something about what motivates consumers to act sustainably based on the work that my colleagues and I do at the University of Groningen. So why doesn't my computer work? Yes. So why do we need psychologists to consider this issue? Well, you probably are well aware of this figure out of the IPCC reports. That's basically because human behavior, our choices, our daily actions are a major contributor to climate change. So we can also mitigate climate change by acting differently. That doesn't mean that the responsibility is all in the consumer's hands, but if we would act differently, climate change would be reduced. So before I start, I want you to think a little bit about the following two questions, and then I will give you the answers. So we did a very large survey, a European social survey, that included questions on whether people believe climate change is happening and whether they think climate change is caused by human actions. So think a little bit about what percentage of these respondents do you think does not believe climate change is happening? So which percentage denies climate change in Europe? Yeah, and then the next question, which percentage does not believe that our actions have anything to do with climate change? So, yeah, so which percentage does deny the human causes? Well, these are the numbers, and I guess that many of you overestimated the percentage of true deniers. That's what I often see when I present this type of data. It's only 2% of the population in Europe that definitely thinks climate change is not happening. The percentage was highest in Poland, and Israel was part of this sample as well. There it was about 9%, 8-9%. And similar numbers have been found in the US, where it's about 8%. But it's not what you commonly think if you listen to the news all the time. And similarly, there's only a very small percentage, again, only 2%, that it thinks it's entirely a natural phenomenon. So it's that many people do believe climate change is happening. Many people do believe that we have a role to play there. So that's not the issue. It's not the main issue to address. We also need to understand why do people not consistently act upon this? Well, that's what I will talk about today. And like I said, climate change is caused by human behavior, and we can do many different things to help mitigate climate change. And that's our daily consumer behavior. It's also the way we produce energy, or which type of energy we buy, like solar panels, or whether we buy wind energy rather than other types of energy, whether we are willing to install batteries to make better use, for example, of our self-generated energy, whether we insulate our house properly, have energy efficient appliances, drive electric vehicles rather than fossil driven cars, but also daily behavior, like if we use line laundry drying rather than a tumble dryer. Meat and dairy consumption is a major contributor to climate change. Travel, flying, and car use has a major impact. It would be better if we more often would use public transport or cycling, like it's often done in the city that I live. But also things like how we vote, or whether we massively protest and demand stricter actions, would all help to mitigate climate change. So because there's so many things that people can do, we are also interested in what general factors can be distinguished that motivate people to engage in pro-environmental actions over and again in many different situations. And one of the general factors that we have often studied are values. And we define values as general goals that people strive for in their life. So what you generally deem important in your life. There's four types of values particularly relevant. First, hedonic values. That means that we want to reduce effort, have a pleasurable life. Second, egoistic values that imply that we want to enhance our resources, save money, for example, but also gain status. These two types of values make us focus on our own interest, on our self-interest. There's also two types of values that make us focus on a collective interest, and that's first altruistic values. People are motivated to protect the interest of others, the well-being of others. And biospheric values, people are also motivated to protect nature and the environment as such. And what we found is that generally in many different countries in the world, the stronger people's egoistic and hedonic values, the less likely they are to act sustainably, while the stronger their altruistic and biospheric values, and particularly the biospheric values, the more likely they are to act sustainably. And fortunately, many people do endorse these biospheric values, so there's a basic motivation to act on climate change. So these are different types of motives that you could also target when you want people to act more pro-environmentally. So what do we see in practice? What are common strategies to promote pro-environmental actions? Well, many times you see information provision strategies, campaigns, for example. And the assumption here is if only people would know, they would act appropriately. They would do the right thing. Another common strategy is targeting people's extrinsic motivation. The assumption being, if we make it attractive or fun or pleasurable, people will do it. And I will discuss both of them and say something about how effective they might be. And then I will go into the role of intrinsic motivation. And that means that people may be motivated to act pro-environmentally because they want to do so, because they find it important to do so, because they find it meaningful to do so. So let's first go information campaigns. Well, these are just some examples of information campaigns that I found on the internet. Often employed strategy, meta-analysis revealed that it is important, but it's oftentimes not effective in changing people's behavior. Many times what you see is that people become more aware of the problem, they understand it better, but it does not necessarily imply that they change their behavior. How come? Well, first, this is not the only type of information that people receive. They also receive opposite information denying climate change. And this might be one of the reasons why you think, and many others think, that many people don't believe in climate change, because these voices are quite prominent in the news. because they have a principle of here the different parties. So there's a lot of information being provided on, or people that deny climate change have a lot of airtime as well. So that's one of the reasons. The other reason I want to demonstrate on the basis of this movie, I hope it still works.
Clearly, somebody in this room murdered Lord Smythe, who, at precisely 3:34 this afternoon, was brutally bludgeoned to death with a blunt instrument. I want each of you to tell me your whereabouts at precisely the time that this dastardly deed took place.
I was polishing the brass in the master bedroom.
I was buttering his lordship's scones below stairs, sir.
Why, I was planting my petunias in the potting shed.
Constable, arrest Lady Smythe.
But how did you know?
Madam, as any horticulturist will tell you, one does not plant petunias until May is out. Take her away.
Sorry, madam.
It's just a matter of observation. The real question is, how observant were you?
Action.
Clearly, somebody in this room murdered Lord Smythe, who, at precisely 3:34 this afternoon, was brutally bludgeoned to death with a blunt instrument. I want each of you to tell me your whereabouts at precisely the time that this dastardly deed took place.
I was polishing the brass in the master bedroom.
I was buttering his lordship's scones below stairs, sir.
I was planting my petunias in the potting shed.
Constable, arrest Lady Smythe.
So this is basically how values work. So if you have a particular, if you strongly endorse a particular type of values, you focus on the consequences of behavior or options for that value. And this colors how you evaluate the option or the behavior. Let me explain it on the basis of a study that we did. Here we showed people a documentary on the negative impact of bottled water use. Half of the people saw this documentary, the other half saw a totally unrelated movie, and the ones that saw the documentary learned that it's not only bad to drink water from plastic bottles because of the plastic, but also because these are transported all over the world. So there's a lot of energy being used to transport water to your home. So what happened if we look at the consequences of on people's awareness and knowledge of the negative consequences of bottled water use? Well, across the board, people who were watching the documentary knew better and were more aware of the negative impacts of bottled water on the environment. We also asked them whether they would intend to reduce the use of bottled water. Across the board, no changes in intentions. Similarly, across the board, no changes in support for policy that would ban the use of or make the use of bottled water less attractive. Then we looked into what happens if you consider the values that people endorsed. And then you see that people with relatively weak biospheric values who don't care that much about the environment, they didn't change their intentions and policy support. But people with strong biospheric values who saw the documentary, they reported to be more likely to reduce the use of bottled water, and they were more in support of policy that would make the selling of bottled water less attractive. So you see that information particularly is appealing to those who value this type of arguments that are being conveyed in the information. So you particularly convince those who care about the topic and not so much people who don't care about the topic. Well, let's briefly discuss the other strategy that I indicated. Targeting extrinsic motivation. This is from a field study that we did in the US at a gas station. We wanted to see whether people would be motivated to check their tire pressure and we communicated different advantages of doing so. So we either said, if you check your tire pressure and your tires are inflated properly, you will save the environment, you emit less CO2. Or we said you would save money by doing so, or we had a control condition with no arguments. So with tire pressure check, you use, if your tires are properly inflated, you use less gasoline. If you use less gasoline, of course you emit less CO2 and you would save money. So think a little bit, a little moment about which appeal would be most effective in your view. Would it be the environmental, the financial, or better, don't come up with any argument. Now, when I ask this, with different audiences, most people indicate the financial appeal would be most effective. And that's also what people themselves tell us. If you just ask different types of populations, they also think the financial appeal would be most effective because it's very tangible and you have it in your pocket right away. You can do something with it. What we found is this is the least effective appeal. The environmental was the most effective. How come? Well, first of all, in this case, if you emphasize the financial benefits, people engage in a cost-benefit analysis and they think, yeah, how much would I save by inflating my tires properly? A few bucks? It's not worth the effort. And that's indeed what we found in a follow-up study. Maybe ask people, how much do you think the following behaviors are worth the effort? And these were all behaviors related to eco-driving. And we either emphasized in the descriptions how much CO2 emissions would reduce, or we indicated how much money they would save. And they find the exact same behavior less worth the effort if we emphasize money instead of CO2 emission reduction. So they just think it's not worth the effort to do this for gaining a little bit of money. So why is the environmental appeal then effective? Well, first of all, many people do care about the environment. These are data from the European Social Survey again, and the blue, the green dots are biospheric values, and the higher the score, the more strongly people endorse these values. And you clearly see that many people relatively strongly endorse biospheric values, much more than hedonic and egoistic values. Altruistic values are also quite strongly endorsed. So many people care about the environment and are willing to do something about it. And this, the other reason is that doing something good for others or the environment makes you feel good because it reflects positively on you and you just get a good feeling by doing a good deed. And that's an old notion already proposed by Aristoteles. He indicated, he labeled this as eudaimonia. And it means that you derive pleasurable feelings and well-being for doing meaningful things, for contributing to the greater good. And that's what we found in a series of studies, that acting sustainably feels good because it's meaningful. And this is particularly the case when you engage in behavior voluntarily, because then you can really claim, it's me, I did it, so it's meaningful to me. And for those with strong biospheric values, because for them, gaining environmental benefits is more valuable. And the interesting thing is that if you anticipate feeling good about pro-environmental actions, it also motivates you to engage in that action. So these the anticipated positive feelings are also a driver for future action. So you can end up in a positive spiral. So we also wanted to know whether this notion of feeling good could be even literally be experienced by people. And this was based on the idea of the warm glow by Andreoni. He indicated that if you do something meaningful, if you do something good, in his case, giving money to charity, he indicated that this could elicit a warm glow. And he used more as a metaphor, and we wanted to see whether this could also literally be the case. And that's actually what we found. So if you ask people to complete a CO2 calculator, you provide them with feedback on their performance, half of them received the information, this is your score, and that's relatively good because most other students scored much lower than you do. Or the other half learned, oh, that's not so good because most of the students scored higher than you did. And then we asked them to indicate how warm they thought it would be in the room. And what we found is that people literally felt warmer. They indicated a higher room temperature when they just learned that they acted relatively pro-environmental, as opposed to not so pro-environmental. We also measured their actual skin temperature as an indicator of whether their actual body temperature changed. And in we run two studies in this case. In the first study, we found that people there was an effect on actual body temperature, but only for female respondents. And we could not replicate it in the second study where the sample size was a little bit lower. So it can either be that we accidentally found it in the first study, or it can be that the effect size is relatively small, so you need large samples to find it. Why only effect of among female participants? Well, human biologists told us later that they only do these type of studies among female respondents because it's about how fast your blood vessels respond to all kinds of external stimuli. That happens faster among female respondents than male respondents. So they would have advised us to only include female respondents in the first place. Okay, so now I indicated that many people care about the environment, they have strong biospheric values. The stronger these biospheric values, the more likely they are to act pro-environmentally and even to derive positive feelings out of it. But what if people do not care about the environment that much? Are these lost groups? Well, there are different ways to motivate them into to act pro-environmentally. And one way is by appealing to their environmental self-identity. So the environmental self-identity is how you think about yourself, to what extent you think you are a pro-environmental person. And the stronger your environmental self-identity, the more likely you are to act sustainably. And that's because we are motivated to act consistently, to be consistent in and act in line with how we see ourselves. The environmental self-identity is stronger when people more strongly endorse biospheric values, which makes sense. But it is also stronger when people realize they acted pro-environmentally in the past. Because if you you think about yourself as a person, you reflect on your past behavior and you think, oh, I acted pro-environmentally, then you're more likely to see yourself as a pro-environmental person and act accordingly. And the interesting thing is that many campaigns do exactly the opposite. They emphasize that that people do not act sustainably yet and they should change their behavior. And this research indicates that you should better emphasize the many things that people already do because then their environmental self-identity is strengthened and then they're more likely to do so over and again. And that's actually what the Dutch government now does in one of their campaigns. It's called Everyone Does Something. And Ellen van der Werf, who did this research in our group, she advised the governments on this campaign. So you see that her research is being implemented in practice. So this is one. Another route that might be relevant is appealing to different types of motivations that people might have. And we wanted to understand what motivates people to act, adopt sustainable innovations. And we studied different sustainable innovations like electric vehicles, but also whether people would join local energy initiative, renewable energy initiative. And basically we found the same results. So I think these results are for the local energy initiative. We first asked people, to what extent are the following motives important for you to engage in these, to become a member of such an initiative? Is this because you think of instrumental reasons, for example, I would save money, or maybe mostly it's a barrier by the way, so it costs me money or it costs me a lot of time. Or is it environmental reasons, or is it because it says something positive about me to self or others? And if you ask people how important these motives are, they indicate, yes, the instrumental factors are important. Yes, the environmental factors are important. But now, showing others who I am or to myself is not an important reason. So the symbolic reason is not really important. Now let's see what predicts their actual interest in such initiative. And now the interesting thing you see, on the right-hand side, you see results of a regression analysis. The higher the coefficient, the more important the factor is as a predictor. You see that instrumental factors are not predictive. What is predictive if people think it would have environmental benefits, and what is even more predictive if people indicate that they think it would say something about who they are to self or others. So the symbolic value, the signaling value is really important. And this is particularly relevant for sustainable innovations because there the signaling value is still very prominent as well because there's hardly anyone still having such innovations. So this is an interesting way to motivate those who are not that much motivated for environmental reasons. Another is involvement in community energy initiatives. So we collaborated here with an organization in the Netherlands that promotes such initiatives. And we wanted to know, does becoming a member of such an initiative motivate people to act more sustainably? You could well say it has no added value because what happens? People who care about the environment become a member and they act sustainably, but they would probably have done so anyway, even if they would have not been a member of an initiative. So does it have added value to be a member? And we found it does. So members act more pro-environmentally, they save more energy, even if you control for their personal motivation to act pro-environmentally, like their biospheric values. So that's good news. These initiatives clearly have good added value. The interesting thing is, what motivates people to become a member then? Is it only the environmental reasons? Is it financial reasons? Or is it also because they want to meet up with others? So are there co-benefits next to the environmental reasons that motivate people to join? And what we find here, again, if you ask people what is important to you, they say finances, yes, important. Money is important to me. Environmental, also important. Meeting up with other people, no, not an important reason. And what we find is what is most predictive of joining is not the money again, but the environmental reasons, but also the social reasons. So many people become a member because they want to interact and meet up with people in their neighborhood. Again, demonstrating that there are co-benefits that you could emphasize to motivate those who are not motivated by the environmental concerns that much. One final, yes, the final one that I want to present, doesn't matter in what type of culture you are. And we studied this in the organizational context as corporate environmental sustainability, and that is the extent to which a company endorses environmental values, has the mission to reduce its environmental impact, and also implemented strategies to reduce its environmental impact. Does this matter? And does it matter in addition to people's environmental values? It does. So first, people with strong biospheric values are more likely to act sustainably at work, demonstrating that these values not only predict your individual behavior at home, but also in other contexts. But people are also more likely to act sustainably at work when they believe their organization is committed to corporate environmental responsibility. So being in a culture where this is advocated makes it more likely that you act sustainably. And for me, the most interesting and surprising finding was, because I would have predicted it otherwise, that this corporate environmental responsibility particularly encourages sustainable behavior when employees do not strongly endorse biospheric values. So it seems that it is particularly motivating those who are not motivated that much themselves. Quite interesting. I'll skip these one for time reasons. So conclusions. Multiple motivations affect sustainable behavior. Different types of values play a role. I hope that I've also shown you that we should not only consider extrinsic motivation, because people not only do things because they want to gain pleasure or money, but they also are intrinsically motivated to act sustainably. And this is a very solid basis for sustained sustainable actions. What is important here that we create a context that activates and supports biospheric values and that offers co-benefits as to motivate people to act sustainably over and again. Finally, I always end up with a sheet with the people from the group, because I have been presenting work of many people in our group. So this is really a common effort, team science, and definitely not only my own research. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a very interesting talk. So, and being on perfectly on time. So now we can proceed with the questions. So the first question is, can we trust what people report about their own values?
Yeah.
Meaning, aren't they subliminally prone to give the right answer or to look for more environmentally friendly or look more environmentally friendly than they are? Or even in the anonymous tests, are there ways to double check this independently?
Yeah, very good question. Thank you. So that's the reason why we never only look at the mean score, but we also look to what extent these predict relevant outcome variables. So it might be that people overreport their biospheric values, but it might also be the other way around, that they underreport the strength of others' values. That's what we found in the study as well. We asked people, to what extent do you care about the environment and to what extent do you think others care about the environment? And then you see that people overestimate the extent to which they themselves, well, I should not say overestimate or underestimate. I should say that they think that they care more about the environment and others than other people do, and that other people are more egoistically and hedonically oriented than they do. But the interesting thing is, if you specify the others as a relatively stereotypical green group, then these differences occur. So it might be that people overreport their environmental values, but still we find that the more strongly people endorse these values, the more likely they are to act pro-environmentally. So they do predict relevant outcome variables. And that's the most important, I think.
Thank you very much. So another question is, what explains the inverse relationship between what individuals indicate as important for their decisions and what ultimately predicts their actions the yeah. most?
Yeah.
Related. Yeah. So how do you go about calculating and measuring the predictive value?
You saw that in different studies, we find it that what people tell us what is driving them is not actually driving them. And there might be multiple reasons for this. It might be that people are presenting themselves in a social desirable way. But it might also be that people really don't truly know what drives them. And with the financial, because I showed two studies where people overestimate the extent to which they were driven by financial reasons. I think it's not, we can't say that financial reasons are not important to people at all. I think they're rather a precondition, because if the financial barriers are very high, many people can't simply afford to do so. So this is a relevant factor to consider, but it's mostly not a decisive factor. So given that something is financially favorable, not everyone will do it. It's more likely that people do it if they support the other motives that I showed you, like environmental motives.
Maybe I have a related question to this financial motivation. Do you think that maybe in developing countries or like poorer countries, this financial motivation may be significantly stronger?
Yeah, that's a very good question as well. And in two ways. I think that financial reasons, as soon as it becomes a barrier, then it is a really important, and it becomes more easy a barrier in less developed countries because they have less to spend, right? The other thing is that you pinpoint to a very relevant point. The studies that I have been presenting were mostly done in the Netherlands, in the US, maybe Europe, for that matter, but not in developing countries. And I think this is something that our community should focus on more. We should see whether our theories also are relevant to explain behavior and preferences in different cultures, especially sustainability issues are worldwide phenomena. So we need far more research in these type of countries.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you very much. So one more related question to this was actually if the data about the importance of the environment for people, if this might be also biased by the fact that some of the studies were done in Europe where there are many pro-environmental oriented countries.
Very good question again. I removed that slide because of time. We did studies in many different countries. And in sociology, you have a theory that says that and caring about the environment is a luxury. Your basic needs need to be fulfilled before you can care about it. And what we found is that across the board, in many different countries and cultures, many people do strongly endorse biospheric values, and the more they do so, the more likely they are to act pro-environmentally. So we also did studies in Africa, Ethiopia, for example, and what was the other one? I can't remember from the top of my head, but also in Mexico, where my student went there, and she purposely targeted low-income groups as well, and she even found that these values are more strongly endorsed among the low-income groups as compared to the high-income groups. But the interesting question is whether this is motivated by the same type of reasons, because it might be that poor people care about the environment because they rely more on the environment and on nature, because they are dependent on it. Mm-hmm. Or it might have cultural reasons or religious reasons to care about the environment. That is something that we still need to dig out. But across the board, many people across many different countries and cultures quite strongly endorse biospheric values.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Then another question. Many people today are very concerned about the climate crisis, but while you mentioned protesting is important, the past year or two have shown the limits of movements like Fridays for Future. Does psychology research tell us how to protest more effectively or put pressure on lawmakers that will lead to more than just empty words and promises?
Yeah. Oh, if I wish I knew the answer. I think these protests did do something because things are changing. Countries are taking efforts. The European Union has announced the Green Deal, they call it, I guess. So things are happening, but still not fast enough. And we still have some political leaders that deny climate change. So that is an issue. But You could say, you would maybe expect they are very influential, but maybe not that much. We will publish a study soon on what happens around the Trump election with environmental concern, because Trump is known as a climate skeptic, right? So we happened to collect data just the day before his election. We didn't expect him to win. And then we took the opportunity to do some follow-up studies. And what we found is that after the election, environmental climate concerns, we focus on climate change, decreased a little bit, but only among those who support him, not among those who hate him. And that's quite a substantial proportion that don't like him. And the other interesting thing is, this happened in the time that he was still known as a climate skeptic. He doesn't hardly ever clearly communicate this message, by the way. If you look at his tweets, he's not truly denying climate change. It's implied in his messaging. But when he withdrew from the Paris Climate Agreement, he used another phrasing, the narrative changed. It was, we want a good deal, suggesting, yeah, climate change is happening, but the Paris Climate Agreement is a bad deal for the US, so we won't support it anymore. And what you see in that period, the Trump supporters went back to the same level of climate concerns as they had before the election. So he has an influence, but not that big. And what you also see in the US at the at the state level, at the city level, many things are happening. So I think these protests help, and we keep on we need to keep on doing it if you want to change something, and maybe join efforts with other parties like industry, companies who also have the same purpose. And we can only really limit climate change if everyone acts together in a coordinated way.
Thank you very much. And maybe we have time for one last question. So about emphasizing the good people already do rather than focusing on negative behavior. So does this not risk that people do a little bit more but stop at a low level and only do what feels convenient to them because they think that they're already doing fine?
Yeah, that's a very nice question, because there have been some studies suggesting that moral hypocrisy might happen. I did my bit, and now I'm excused to do bad things again. But based on this research, you would say that this is not likely to happen because it is a self-reinforcing process. It's not about, oh, I have an excuse, I did my what I did. It's really that you become you to see yourself as a more pro-environmental person, and that motivates you to act consistently over and again. And one of our current PhDs is looking into this, whether this consistency process is happening, and that people are more likely to act in the same way over and again because they want to be consistent. And we seem to find support for this reasoning. So I would say that this would exactly say state the opposite, that moral licensing is less likely to happen.
So thank you once again for an amazing talk and very interesting answers. Thank you.